those of you who don't know me, my name is Andrew Krepinevich. I'm president of the Center for Strategic and Budgetary Assessments. I'd like to welcome you here this morning to hear a presentation by Bryan on our new report, Commanding the Seas, Reinvigorating the U.S. Navy Surface Warfare Fleet. We're very fortunate to have with us here this morning Senator Tammy Baldwin, her bio in your program, strong supporter of a strong national defense in general, and in particular, a friend of the Navy and a strong proponent of a strong surface fleet. And we're delighted to have her here with us. She's on a very tight schedule. So without any further ado, Senator, thanks so much for coming.
Thank you very much. Good morning. Thank you very much. It's good to be here, and I thank you all for attending. I am pleased to at least be here for the kickoff of the rollout of Bryan Clark's report on the future of the U.S. Navy's surface fleet. The Center for Strategic and Budgetary Assessment has a well-earned reputation here on Capitol Hill as an innovative, nonpartisan national security research firm that research that policymakers have long relied on to help inform decisions on very difficult matters. So I want to thank personally Bryan for and the CSBA for kicking off this important conversation, especially as it comes at such a critical time. I agree with the report's underlying premise that the Navy's surface fleet is at a crossroads. As you all know, the United States faces a dynamic and increasingly challenging threat environment. At the same time, the Navy, like all federal entities, is dealing with fiscal constraints. And with the budget sequester cuts resuming in future years, the Navy's acquisition budget will only be further constrained. So while the threats aren't going away, the Navy will have fewer resources to combat them. Put another way, budget levels may change, but the Navy will still need to project power across the world's waters and control the maritime environment to safeguard our security and our economic interests. Accordingly, it's critical that the Navy procures ships that find the correct balance between capability and affordability throughout the acquisition life cycle. While it's not always an easy needle to thread, Bryan makes a number of recommendations on this front. One recommendation that I'd like to highlight deals with the path forward on the Littoral-combat ship and what's to come after the LCS, what's called the follow-on small surface combatant. Now, it may not come as a surprise to this well-informed audience, but the Freedom variant of the LCS is built in Marinette, Wisconsin. And I say this because a lot of people aren't familiar with Wisconsin's strong shipbuilding industry. You know Wisconsin for cheese, brats, and beer. You know that because we produce them well, and that's why you know about it. But we also make great ships. And I take great pride in representing the people of Wisconsin in the United States Senate. And I'm proud to represent the 93 Wisconsin companies that supply parts and help in building the Littoral Combat Ship at Marinette Marine. The LCS is fast, versatile, fuel efficient, highly capable, and a relatively speaking inexpensive ship. Moreover, it meets critical warfighting needs. The Navy has consistently deemed it essential to its mission. It's important to note that the LCS was envisioned to be a cost-conscious vessel that was smaller, more versatile, and more agile than a frigate, but larger and more capable than the coastal patrol ship or a mine countermeasure ship. The LCS is meeting all of those requirements. In other words, the LCS is doing just what it was meant to do. But with the discussion to truncate the LCS program to 32 ships, the Navy is in the process of determining new operational concepts and associated requirements for the follow-on small surface combatant, and whether to backfit existing LCS to be more lethal and survivable. In this area, I agree with the report's recommendations that selecting a modified LCS as a follow-on small surface combatant, thereby leveraging lessons learned and the investments made, is the best option for meeting the Navy's requirements on a timely and affordable manner. Just as Marinette Lockheed team built a quality and affordable ship in the LCS, I am confident that they will do the same with a modified LCS, including incorporating new offensive and defensive capabilities. A modified LCS as a follow-on small surface combatant isn't just right for the Navy because it's affordable, versatile, and effective, but it's the right thing for our national security needs. As regions like the South China Sea and the Straits of Hormuz continue to be potential flash spots in our future, we need ships that can operate effectively in contested littoral seas, and we need those ships on schedule and on cost. So I want to again thank Bryan Clark and the CSBA for their contributions to this very vital discussion. Our national security depends on a strong and sustainable Navy, and this report makes progress toward that goal. I thank you all for being interested and here and engaged today. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Baldwin. That was a great summary, not only of your philosophy, but also a lot of the key points in Bryan Clark's report. Excuse me. We're fortunate also to have with us this morning Congressman Reid Ribble, also from the state of Wisconsin. We had a very nice conversation out in the foyer there, waiting for the event to begin. And I must say, the senator's dedication to national security and to the strength of our Navy is exceeded only by his love of a football team up in that neck of the woods. And I got a great history of the Green Bay Packers, in addition to a nice overview of the Congressman's thoughts on maritime issues in the fleet. So without any further interruption, let me introduce Congressman Reid Ribble. Sir?
It actually would be more fun to talk about the Packers. Bryan, thanks for your work. I thought the report was outstanding. I want to try to give you, because Senator Baldwin just kind of laid out the state of play on surface combatants and why the need for the littoral combat ship specifically. But I want to take my time this morning and talk a little bit about the state of play in Congress as it relates to national defense, in particular to the Navy, as we drill down deeper into it. The very moment that threats are expanding globally, the Congress is wrestling with a $17 trillion national debt and trying to balance the relationship between the threat and the relationship between the use of taxpayer dollars for any particular funding mechanism. I want you to think in terms of, rather from left to right, I'm trying to do it this your way so you can see it, from left to right of progressivism to conservatism, to not think of it in terms of being linear, because it's not linear, and it's certainly not linear in the halls of Congress. It's more in terms of a circle. And as you move to conservatism to its furthest right and liberalism to its furthest left, ultimately it meets in a blend of a libertarianism. And so you have represented here in the halls of Congress, both in the U.S. House and the U.S. Senate, everybody along the entire spectrum, from progressive thought to conservative thought to libertarian thought, and all of these carry a different worldview as it relates to national defense. Herein lies the challenge for the Pentagon and the Department of Defense and for military experts to help take the parochial nature of those individual members of Congress and try to build a case for a robust national defense that will ensure America's prosperity for our progeny going forward forever, and to play the role that we've been rightly given and have assumed over the course of history. Now, as it relates to just military and national defense, there must be a symmetry between a nation's capability and its will to use it. When, in fact, we are not symmetrical with capability and will, and we get out of balance, then that is where the biggest risk to any nation resides. And inside that political spectrum, we have those who have great will, but don't always support providing and funding for the capability that is necessary to meet the will. At the same hand, we have those who are willing to provide the capability, but then resist the will to use the capability. Globally, national defense is all about contact. What are we doing relationally with those who would oppose us and our allies who would support us, and how visible are we in those regions of the world? When you blend contact and you have capability and you have will, you now have the most strong position that you can have globally for national defense. All of us that are concerned about these issues must begin to make the argument and the case that we should pull our nation's capability and its will in alignment, and then provide the vehicle for contact globally so that we can meet the needs of this nation going forward, and more importantly, we can meet the needs of the globe going forward. One of the reasons I'm so supportive of the Littoral-combat program has nothing to do with the fact that that ship is built in my congressional district. In fact, I think my platform would be stronger in support if, in fact, it were not built in my congressional district. Because now I am subject to the accusation, well, you just want that because it's built there. It's totally untrue. I want it because I want our capability and our will brought into symmetry so that they're totally balanced, and that then we can project and provide for global peace. That's what military should be about. We think in terms of global military to be about war. The United States has never been about war. It has always been about peace, and its strength and its symmetry between capability and will is not about making war, but about preventing it. And so, therefore, those members of Congress that can see this in its broad strokes are supportive of trying to build the Navy and its surface fleet to a place where we can continue to have that symmetry in play. Now, let's get to the parochial nature. Not everybody agrees. And so, therefore, the argument and case must be made. And in our system of government, a civilian-led Congress, a civilian-led military, has the power of the purse to do these things and to try to find the place. And so it is up to the American people to weigh in with their individual members of Congress without regard to where ships are built, without regard to where we're building aircraft or any place else, where we're refueling aircraft carriers, without regard to its location. It is important for the American people to weigh in on what the role of the United States defense should look like in the future. It's important for you to weigh in, Bryan, on what this should look like, and that we have the broadest framework with which to make these decisions. And you must weigh in with members of Congress. There is never, and maybe in my lifetime, a no more important moment in U.S. history than the one we're facing right now. Because quite frankly, our national debt is not symmetrical with what our own objectives are. And it creates tremendous pressure on members of Congress to cast votes that are important on behalf of global peace. But global peace is always not only the right moral choice, it is the right economic choice to be made. And so while you're here and you're spending your time today in your meetings, I would pay close attention, and I would ask probing questions so that you can have in your own mind clarity on how we get to the end result that is absolutely necessary for us to have. And that is the strongest, most efficient, and deadly surface fleet on the planet. Therefore, as those risks expand and as those risks grow, and we're seeing what's going on in China, with stealth technology, their own investment in their own Navy, which, by the way, historically is out of sync with where the Chinese have been for millennia. The Chinese have never been imperialistic, and they are now. And so there is no more moment in history where we ought to have
increased contact, where we ought to have increased capability and increased will to use that capability than at this very moment of history. And so pay attention today. And then speak out on behalf, where you have an opportunity to talk with members of Congress, speak out on behalf of what you've learned. I appreciate the work that you're doing, Andy, and I appreciate the fact that you've invited me here to have just a few minutes of conversation with you. Your work is really important, and I thank you for it. Thanks for being here today.
Thank you, Congressman Ribble. I think that was a, sort of a great compliment to Senator Baldwin's comments, one focusing on more of the specifics of the fleet, and the Congressman's remarks sort of taking us up to 50,000 feet, if you will, strategically looking at the context in which we have to make decisions about the fleet.